Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the COVID-19 committee in 2021. Gordon Lyndhurst, MSP, who has an interest in the matters we are considering today, also joins us, and I welcome Gordon to the meeting. Gordon, do you have any registrable interests relevant to the committee's remit that you wish to declare?
I have no interest to declare other than what's in my register of interest, so nothing in respect of the committee's meeting today, thank you.
Thank you for that. I will now move to the first item on the agenda, which is a decision to take agenda item 3, consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private? And if any member disagrees, can they please indicate this in the chat function now? I can see that no member has indicated they disagree, and as such, we are all agreed. I will now turn to agenda item 2, which is a evidence session where the committee will be taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, John Swinney, MSP, and Professor Jason Leach, who is the National Clinical Director for the Scottish Government. This session gives members the opportunity to take evidence on this week's review of the levels restrictions, and in particular, the regulations arising from the First Minister's statement on the 4th of January 2021, which are entitled the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 10 Regulations 2020-2021, SSI 2021/1. I would also note that SSI 2021/3, known as the Number 11 Regulations, were laid after the meeting papers were published. The number 11 regulations are therefore not formally on the agenda, but have been circulated to members because they relate to the First Minister's statement on Monday. Deputy First Minister, can I welcome you to the meeting and can I invite you to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity to meet with the committee this morning and to have the opportunity to update the committee on this week's stay-at-home announcement. We face a challenging set of circumstances as we enter 2021. In the week up to the 3rd of January, there was an alarming rise in the prevalence of the virus. The percentage of positive tests doubled and the cumulative 7-day incidence per 100,000 of the population rose to 291. There's also growing evidence that tells us that this new variant is significantly more transmissible than earlier strains. And we know this strain is increasing in prevalence in Scotland and now accounts for almost half of our cases. That is why the advice from our clinicians was that more was needed to be done to slow the spread, to save lives and to protect the NHS from becoming overwhelmed. That unfortunately meant tougher restrictions, and as the new strain appears to infect young people more easily, it also meant that we needed to take steps to limit interactions amongst younger people as well. In short, it has become necessary to return to a situation much closer to the lockdown of last March. That is why the First Minister announced additional measures for all areas that were in level 4. I won't list every change, as I know the committee will be familiar with the content, but in summary, the additional restrictions include a legal requirement to stay at home except for essential purposes, reducing the number of people 12 and above who can meet outside to 2, anyone shielding and who cannot work from home should not go to work. Places of worship have closed except for funerals and weddings with reduced numbers. Wakes and post-funeral gatherings cannot take place. And some additional premises, service providers and retailers have also closed. We've also taken the difficult decision that schools, including nursery schools, will not go back until the 1st of February. Only vulnerable children and children of key workers will attend class in person. And we will continue to review the arrangements around the resumption of full-time schooling in relation to the prospective commencement date of the 1st of February. I know that remote learning presents challenges and we will work with local authorities and schools to support teachers, children and parents throughout this time. These measures are expected to have a significant impact in reducing opportunities for the virus to be transmitted. However, we recognise that they bring with them other harms to families, communities and business, and we'll work together with our partners to do all that we can to mitigate these. It is proposed that these additional protective measures should remain in place until at least the end of January and will be kept under close review. However, we cannot at this stage rule out keeping them in place longer, nor making further changes. There is, though, a light at the end of the tunnel, but well over 100,000 people have now received their first dose of the vaccine. As the rollout continues at pace, we must do what we can to support that journey back to a healthy economy and slow the spread. We are, as ever, hugely thankful to the efforts of our citizens, communities and businesses for keeping themselves and others safe. I look forward to addressing the questions that the committee will have this morning, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. And I'll now turn to questions. Can I remind members that we have approximately 10 minutes each for questions per member? So it would be helpful if we could keep our questions and answers concise. And if there's time for supplementary questions, I'll indicate this once all members have had a chance. And if I can begin by asking the first question, just touch on something that the Deputy First Minister has mentioned in terms of transmissibility amongst young people, and just explore that. Can you illuminate the committee in terms of what specific evidence the Scottish Government has in relation to that issue, in relation to children being more infectious or the virus being able to transmit more easily?
I will, Convener, and I'll bring in Professor Leach, obviously, to provide some of the clinical foundation to these points as well. What is clear from the evidence that we have on transmissibility is that there is an increasing prevalence of the virus amongst younger people. So the, I suppose the best way to explain it is that the proportion of young people that are testing positive is representing a greater proportion of the number of positive cases that are being identified compared to previous strains of the virus. And as a consequence, we have to take account of that finding, although I think it would be fair to say at this stage we are not, the evidence is not conclusive that although young people are acquiring the virus to a greater extent, it does not yet appear that the effect of the virus is any more intense on those young people, nor that we are certain the extent to which young people are transmitting it greater to other individuals as a consequence. I think that's the best headline summary I can give of the evidence to date, but Professor Leach will be able to provide further detail on the studies that have been undertaken to represent this point.
Thanks, Deputy First Minister and Convener. Hello again, everybody. It's nice to be back, and a Happy New Year to everybody. The Deputy First Minister is correct that the evidence is inconclusive at this point, but there appears to be a proportionate increase in transmissibility across the age ranges. So that would mean a 17-year-old would have a proportionate increase in transmissibility, just like a 30 or a 40-year-old would. There is no evidence yet that a 3 or a 4-year-old transmits this virus in any more meaningful way than it did before, because it barely transmitted it earlier. The challenge here is it takes a bit of time to work that out, because in the southeast of England and London, this variant has been around for longer, but it still takes a bit of time to work out if the age ranges are transmitting it, pushing it on to older people or amongst their own groups. And that's why the precautionary advice was given around schools and early learning centres in the last couple of weeks. We know now that there are two principal theories about why this is true. One is cellular adhesion, so the virus attaches easier, and one is viral load, therefore you get more virus. So that could happen at all age ranges, and we have to know at what point it happens and what point it doesn't. And that's what the research is doing, both in the southeast of England and around the world and in Scotland, to see if that remains true. So we think probably there is a proportionate increase in transmissibility across age ranges, and that would be true in late teenagers, just as it would be in 40-year-olds.
Thank you for that. Can I ask next about the recent change to the schedule for administering two doses of the vaccine, whereby the second dose is going to be delayed in order to provide the first dose to a greater number of people? And I accept this is a UK-wide decision. But in terms of issues that might arise from that. Is the Scottish Government satisfied that the protection offered from the first dose is acceptable for each of the two vaccines currently available? And secondly, in terms of public confidence, is enough being done to ensure that people have faith in this change in regime and that that they're going to return for the second dose in due course?
I'll say a little first, Kavina, and then I'll come to Jason Leach. I think the advice that we've had substantiates the position that we have adopted, that the establishment of a longer gap between the first and the second dose enables us to achieve the objective that you've highlighted, Convener, of being able to vaccinate more people with one dose at an earlier stage than would have been the case had the gap period being 3 rather than 12 weeks. And that advice has come from the clinical advice that we have has been formulated and tested and assessed and judged to be appropriate. And as a consequence, that enables us, I think, to build public confidence around the fact that more individuals will see the rollout of the vaccine over a shorter space of time than would ordinarily have been the case with the previous arrangements. I think in terms of the question of is enough being done to build public confidence and to communicate that message, I think that I would accept that's an ongoing priority that we must continue to set out. And I know that the Chief Medical Officer, the National Clinical Director and their clinical colleagues are very active in communicating that message, because I think fundamentally it is important that that message is explained by clinicians on the basis of the substance behind the clinical advice that supports such a position. And I think public confidence, Convener, will be inextricably linked to the volume of people who become involved in the vaccination system. So I think the more people become present for vaccine, they get called for vaccine, the quicker that can happen and the greater number of individuals that can be affected will help to build public confidence. And I think will ensure that people are committed to securing the first and the second doses of the vaccine so that they can achieve the protection that is available from the vaccine. And as a consequence, we will see that incremental build-up of public confidence around the vaccine strategy. And I'll invite Professor Leach to add to that.
Thanks, Deputy First Minister, and thanks, Convener. It gives me a moment. Forgive me, this answer may be slightly longer than you would hope for, but I'll be as quick as I can. Just a matter of 3 or 4 weeks ago, when I was here, we discussed this, and my answer described standard immunological practice where first dose gives you some protection, second dose gives you greater protection. So we were all very pleasantly surprised with the trial data. And the trial data wasn't available when we last spoke, but now on the 8th of January, the science has changed. That is the headline news. And that science has changed because the phase 3 trials have reported out and the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation has seen both published and unpublished data and done its own analysis. And it has advised us that this is the way to save the most lives. That's the simple equation. Now, there is some confusion out there about 52% protection and 90% protection. So let me just try and clear that up as quickly as I can. The published trial in the New England Journal talks about 52% protection from the first dose of the Pfizer vaccine. They took everybody who got dose one and they checked how many people get the virus, because no vaccine in the world is 100% effective. The flu vaccine isn't, the measles vaccine isn't, and nor will COVID vaccines be. And they got a number of people who got the infection. Some of those people got the infection in the first 14 days of post-vaccination. They were never going to be protected with the vaccine. The vaccine can't protect you in 14 days. It takes 14 to 21 days for it to be protected. So when you add all those people together, you get 52%. The Joint Committee analysed the data in more depth. The table is available at the Joint Committee and in the New England Journal article, in fact. If you remove those people who got the virus early, which is a completely legitimate thing to do, you get a much higher level of protection from day 21 and day 22 onwards. It's not an exact time, of course. It's about 3 weeks when your immunity seems to be very good to this virus. We also have parallel research on natural immunity, people who are getting the infection, not getting the vaccine, and we now know that lasts for up to 6 months. We just don't know if it will keep going for longer. So the Joint Committee, 30 years of advice, independent, not government scientists, despite what you might read, independent scientists, immunologists, virologists, public health professionals, their advice was to save the most lives, I'm sorry to be so blunt, to save the most lives, first dose in as many people as you can, and a 12-week gap to second injection. And that's the advice they gave, and that's the advice we took. We have never departed from Joint Committee advice in 30 years. And we took that advice in good faith. We passed it on to the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet, and they took that advice.
Thank you for that. I'm sure other members will want to explore the sort of issues around that. My final question is an education-based one. The committee's received various submissions from parents about the effect that closing early learning centres has on the well-being of children and their families. And I just wondered if the Deputy First Minister could give the rationale for that decision. I think there has been evidence for the Department for Education in England that shows that preschool children are less susceptible to infection. Was this a preventative step, or was there some other basis for that decision?
Essentially, our moves on education, convener, are designed to address two factors. The first is, and this extends beyond early learning and childcare, the first is that obviously if the success that we've had since August in sustaining our schools and early learning centres has been open throughout has largely been based on the fact that we have managed to secure pretty low levels of community transmission of the virus. And they were very, very low in August when schools returned. They've ebbed and flowed in the period since then. But the decision we came to, and which was announced on Monday, was a consequence of the fact that we are seeing very aggressive rates of increase in community transmission. And the numbers I shared with the committee indicate that on the last data available to me and a local authority background breakdown, shows 299 cases per 100,000, which is a dramatically different position to where we have been in Scotland. So, therefore, the likelihood was that there would be significant disruption to education as a consequence of that level of community transmission that would be involved. So, we took a preventative step to address that issue. Second factor is obviously that if we want to reduce community transmission, we have to reduce interaction within our society as a whole. And whilst young children in the early learning sector may not be more susceptible or greater prevalence of transmitting the virus, the movements that are around them coming to early learning settings, being in early learning centres and going home from early learning centres involve a significant amount of human interaction within our society. And fundamentally, the difficult decision that we've had to take is to reduce the amount of human interaction within our society, to ensure that we create fewer bridges for the virus to spread from individual to individual. So that's a societal-wide objective and approach that has an effect on the early learning centre settings and also on school settings into the bargain.
Thank you very much for that. Can I turn next to the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. At the moment, it does look like there's more people out and about in workplaces and on public transport compared to last spring. So my question, I suppose, first of all, to you, Deputy First Minister, are you worried that there are still too many people going out to workplaces, and if so, what further action is the Scottish Government considering taking to ensure more people stay at home? And apart from what government can do, what is your message to those employers who are perhaps putting unreasonable and unsafe pressure onto their staff, and what will happen to those employers who do undermine health protection measures?
In answering that question, Convener, I would essentially start with where I closed my last answer to the Convener's question, which is there is a necessity for there to be a society-wide effort to reduce human interaction within the country. So that requires people to follow and organisations to follow and to apply the stay-at-home, apart from for essential purposes, advice that has been issued by the government. Not advice, requirement. And I think it's important that I stress the requirement in law that people stay at home unless they have a reasonable excuse to leave home. Now, we are monitoring very closely the levels of interaction within society. We're monitoring closely public transport use, we're monitoring closely traffic data, we're monitoring closely all of the information that's available to us around the level of movement in society. And I think Monica Lennon is probably correct in that the volumes of movement in society are greater than they were in the period immediately following lockdown in March of 2020. So we will have to monitor, we are monitoring those issues very carefully with a view to potentially having to put in further measures that would further constrain the ability of individuals to have reasonable excuse to be at work, for example, and for employers to essentially justify individuals being at work. Now, there is, you know, if we take some examples, you know, for example, construction sector. The construction sector has done a great deal of work to ensure that sites are able to operate on a safe basis and that they have safe working practices that are consistent with the government's requirements in this respect. But if, even though that work is undertaken on that basis, there is still too much movement in society, and we do not see a reduction in the level of infectiousness within the country, then we may well have to take further action as a consequence. So I would want to be clear with the committee that these are issues that we are monitoring very closely and carefully, and may result in us taking further action to apply greater restrictions if we don't see a fall in the level of infectiousness within the country, because we have to see that, because that will be the route by which we have reassurance that we are reducing the potential for there to be a significant caseload on the National Health Service, which might turn into an unbearable caseload within the National Health Service at a time when we know we already have a more acute and challenging situation in the National Health Service as a consequence of normal habitual winter pressures, some of which have been exacerbated by the weather that we've had in the last few days, where cases presenting to accident and emergency have been affected by the degree of ice and weather trauma that have unfortunately affected a number of individuals within our society. And of course, if the health service is dealing with the consequences of ice trauma, because more and more people are out and about within our society, that doesn't leave as much capacity to deal with the COVID issues. And if we've got too much movement in society, we'll have too many COVID cases. So it's all interlinked, and that's why we're monitoring very carefully all of the data in that respect.
Thank you. For those workers who are essential and do have to go out to work, but then find they need to self-isolate, can I ask what else the Scottish Government is planning to do to increase financial support to that cohort of workers? And you'll remember last year with the coronavirus emergency legislation, Parliament agreed to amend the bill to secure a support fund for care workers, because during the first wave we had lots of low paid care workers having to choose between health and hardship. So that fund helped them to be able to self-isolate and stay at home safely. Is that something that could be expanded to other groups of workers?
I think fundamentally the issue relates here to the degree of sustainability we can put in place to support individuals who are required to self-isolate in whatever circumstance. And we made a judgment about the availability of the self-isolation grant, which remains available to individuals who are eligible. And that, of course, is based very much on trying to address the question of designing an approach which is financially sustainable or offers financial sustainability to the individuals that are affected. And not every individual is going to require that, because of their financial and employment circumstances. But what we've tried to do is to make sure that we have a targeted and focused approach that supports exactly the individuals that Monica Lennon raises in her question to me, who need to be supported because they don't have financial sustainability without having that self-isolation grant. So we've tried to design an approach which meets the needs of individuals who are severely affected by this, because we cannot have a situation where there is an obstacle to an individual self-isolating because of the question of financial sustainability, because that will undermine our efforts to try to interrupt the spread of the virus.
Thank you. Probably my last question, given the time. So if I can perhaps turn to Professor Leach. I was wondering if you could give us an update on what the R number is presently, and if I can ask about the vaccine in the context of one particular group of healthcare workers, our home care workforce. Can we get an update, please, on when those workers can expect to be vaccinated? And the Deputy First Minister mentioned the weather and ice trauma, and we know that's had a real impact for individuals and the NHS in recent days. I think many of us have had home carers and their families get in touch because people have slipped on the ice when they've been going out to care for people in the community. So can I ask what work is ongoing to risk assess the work of home care staff? And can we get some idea how things are going in terms of routine testing, vaccine and PPE for those workers, please?
Yeah, so the modelling will be published either tonight or today, perhaps. I can't remember exactly when we published the latest modelling, but the R number is touching and over one. It actually doesn't need the big computer to tell us that. We can work it out ourselves, can't we, from 700 on the 19th of December to 2,700 yesterday, or 2,500 yesterday. So the R number must be above one. It simply must be. So that the range is about 0.9 to 1.3. It's very difficult to be accurate in a population of our size. And it's similar across the UK, but that hides particular patches of much higher R. It maybe is worth saying that in November, during London and the South East pretty major lockdown, they managed to get their R number to 1.4. Remember, we got our R number in our previous lockdown to 0.7. That's the new variant. That's the new variant. It's partly about compliance and fatigue and people getting fed up with it, but it's principally the new variant. And that's why the lockdown has to be as harsh as it is, I'm afraid. And that's why Mr. Swinney is absolutely correct that we need to consider even more if we don't see that number turn. Employed care workers, so health and social care workers, will come to unpaid carers in a moment, but health and social care workers in priority group number one, of course, you can't do them all on the same day, and some are easier to get to, if you'll forgive the language, than others. The AstraZeneca vaccine is much, much more transportable, much easier to get to, slightly more distant communities. So those health and social care workers will be done in the next 3 or 4 weeks. And if they aren't, there will be mechanisms for them to contact the line managers inside our health service and our social care system to get those people done. So if they are employed by social care or by the health service, they are in that first group. Unpaid carers are a different challenge, and that's partly what you asked, and I'll come to the risk assessment of those going in and out of houses for us in a moment or two. Unpaid carers further down the priority list, principally because they tend to be in a smaller group of individuals they care for. So they're not quite at much as higher risk as care workers, for instance, from a Glasgow City Council, who might be in and out of 15 houses rather than an unpaid carer who may look after one or two parents or kids or whatever. So the Joint Committee say they should be in the priority list, but slightly further down the priority list, because the priority list is about a mortality risk. I completely agree with you that the kind of perfect storm of those care workers, particularly those who aren't in a hospital environment or a care home environment, going door to door, house to house in small groups, sometimes alone, sometimes in the dark, first thing in the morning and now at 4:30 in the evening. It's a really, really difficult job, and I'm enormously grateful for everything they do to keep the system moving. They have access to PPE. They will have access to vaccine. They'll just have to be a little patient. Some of them are done, and we'll get to the others. They are in the priority group, as are their those they care for. Remember, though many of them will be over 80 and will be caught in this first net, and then the over 75s progressively downwards. We have been in touch with the councils, the local authorities. They're working hugely hard to grit the pavements to get that done. There was a particular horrible morning when it rained and then it iced in half an hour, and there's pretty much nothing they can do. I got a long explanation from my local authority colleagues about why you simply cannot do anything about that. But then they've tried the best they can to recover. So all of that in a loop, run by the local authorities principally, with our oversight and our influence, and Mr. Swinney and Ms. Campbell looking after that as best we can. But it's an absolute priority, you're right.
Thank you for that. Can I turn next to Mark Ruskell, please?
Thanks, Convener. Morning to you both. Can I just start with a quick question for John? Does the government accept now that teachers are more at risk of contracting COVID than the rest of the general population?
No.
Okay. Do you have particular evidence to back up that position, John?
Yes, I think the ONS study I think gives the demonstration that that is the case, that the prevalence of the effect of the virus on the teaching population in general is not any different to the working population of similar age groups. There is one particular group of younger male teachers where there is a slight difference in prevalence, but across the range of the whole teaching population, the ONS survey and the Public Health Scotland data that shows the extent to which teachers are contracting the virus is not in any way different from other working cohorts within the population.
Okay, can I stay with education and ask you for some clarity on the way that pupils with additional support needs are being defined as vulnerable? I mean, obviously, you know, those with SN needs are a very diverse group of young people, very, very, you know, diverse needs within that group as well. Some of them, it may be more appropriate for them to be at home. Some of them may be more appropriate for them to be in school. But can I ask you about a particular situation, say where you have a special needs school or an additional support needs department within a school? It is possible, is it not, that all of those young people that get their education from that department or from that school may actually come into school now and no doubt be eligible to come into school because they're defined as vulnerable children. Is that being taken into account in the guidance? And how do you think schools are preparing for that? Because obviously, if you're a teacher and you're managing a special needs school and you're preparing to open that up, you know, that raises perhaps some concerns in relation to the number of young people that may be attending and how to keep them safe.
This is a very difficult issue because I think, as Mr. Ruskell makes clear, that there is a huge range of circumstances that will that will affect young people who are defined as having additional support needs. And within that grouping, there will be, in the current context, some young people who are better served being in an educational environment and some who will be better served being in a home environment or receiving other support. So it's a very difficult situation to generalise about, because I think by the nature of additional support needs, the situation is very, very specific to each individual. For that reason, we have structured the guidance in a fashion to give as much clarity to aid decision-making within individual schools about how best to meet the needs of each individual child. Now, should a decision be taken that it is most appropriate for a young person, due to their vulnerability, to be included within school, then all of the proper mitigations have got to be undertaken to enable that to be sustained. So therefore, all the protections that need to be in place have got to be applied, all of the arrangements to maintain and to minimise any possible risk must be assured and applied in all circumstances. But fundamentally, that has to be a judgment arrived at by the dialogue with individual families, which individual schools will take forward within the framework of the guidance that we've put in place.
Mm. Does that deal with then the potential issue where, say, if you had a special needs school where all of the pupils are technically defined as vulnerable, does that deal with that potential concentration effect of a large number of vulnerable people being in the same school? Because you talk about very much a one-to-one judgment there, which I think might work within mainstream education, but within a special needs setting, I could see that as being quite different.
I think it does, because I think the same issues of the range of needs and circumstances and context will apply in a special needs school as much as it applies in a mainstream school. So there will be a range of circumstances and details of cases as they present themselves. So schools will be able to make those judgments about the degree to which there is a need to reflect the individual circumstances of individual children. Now, obviously, we've got to very carefully look at these circumstances, and we will see this as the days take their course over the next few weeks, and we see the numbers of young people, children and young people, that are presenting for schooling, and we'll obviously have to monitor that very carefully, because to go back to my answer to the convener a few moments ago, one of the unfortunate requirements we're having to address here is the fact that we need to reduce human interaction within our society because of where the virus is. And unfortunately, education is being affected by that in a way that I would have preferred not to be the case, but it is. And therefore, we have to look at that, at the level of attendance and human interaction, to make sure that the strategic purpose of reducing human interaction is being achieved by the steps that we take in relation to the delivery of education.
Okay. Can I go back to the issue that was raised recently about self-isolation? I mean, it seems now that self-isolation is more important than ever, and supporting people self-isolate is more important than ever. And I did raise this with Jean Freeman just before Christmas, and she said that in the chamber that consideration is being given to what more we can do to support people to self-isolate, and you've already outlined the change in the conditions in relation to the applicability for self-isolation support grant. I want to know what more you are doing right now. I mean, Jean said that on the 23rd of December. Are you considering changing the criteria again? Has the criteria changed that you've already implemented? Is it actually working? Because ultimately people are making decisions here, and I'm still getting, you know, phone calls from constituents, people who are really struggling to make that right decision, given that in many cases they won't be getting full statutory, it's full sick pay. They'll only be getting the £96 minimum. What action do you take?
Well, we've taken some action in relation to the changes to the self-isolation grant support to try to address exactly the circumstances that Mr. Russell puts to me. And we need to continue to monitor the effectiveness of those measures. I think the steps that we've taken have been generally welcomed as steps to try to ensure a greater effectiveness of the role of self-isolation, because it's absolutely correct, self-isolation is crucial to interrupting the spread of the virus. And we will continue to look at whether or not all of the measures that we have in place are providing the necessary support to individuals. That remains a constant priority within government, and we will assess whether or not the steps that we have made already have been sufficient to encourage greater compliance around the requirements of self-isolation, which are crucial in helping us in the efforts we're engaged in stopping the spread of the virus.
When will we know if it's been effective or not? I mean, it's been, what, a couple of months now since that change was put in place? I'm still getting calls from people who are struggling to access the support grants and clearly need it. So when are we going to know?
Well, I think we look at these things on an ongoing basis, and you know, we're looking at all of the support arrangements that we have in place to make sure that we have them all sufficiently focused and targeted to meet the objectives that we take forward. So these issues are looked at on a regular basis by ministers. We continue to consider any evidence that's available to us to support these efforts. We're undertaking information gathering on the extent of compliance that is underway in relation to self-isolation. Indeed, there's a significant workstream within government on the whole arguments around compliance, how we can encourage and motivate greater compliance, and how we can put in place the specific measures that assist in that respect. And Shirley Ann Somerville, the Social Security Secretary, leads responsibility for the compliance activity within government, and obviously she has a very close involvement in the issues in connection with the self-isolation grant. So those factors will all be part of the discussion and decision making that we take forward.
Thank you for that. Can I turn next, please, to Beatrice Wishart?
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, this question is related to the Convener's last question, actually. Many families are frustrated that they don't qualify for an in-school or nursery provision because parents aren't classified as key workers, while other parents who can't work from home are organising informal childcare with neighbours and relatives, where one person will look after children from a number of families. So consequently, there's multiple household mixing. The suggestion is that there would be less household mixing if more formal arrangements in regulated educational settings were available. So given the need to reduce human interaction, how would you comment on that?
I think this gets to the nub of the extent to which we can reduce human interaction. And you know, my answer to Monica Lennon, I think, could only be interpreted as an answer which would be a holding answer, that we need to see just how effectively we are able to reduce human interaction on the degree of restrictions that we have put in place. And if we do not see a reduction in human interaction as a consequence of those restrictions, then there is every likelihood that we will have to put in place further restrictions as a consequence to ensure that we reduce that degree of activity within our society. So the question is is a very serious one, because it gets to the heart of the necessity to reduce human interaction within our society. So whichever way we look at this, whether it's about where people are employed, whether they are able to work from home, where they are able to find childcare, all of these factors contribute to the level of human interaction within our society, and there may be a necessity for us to restrict that further if we don't see that reducing as a consequence of the steps that we are taking already. I don't think the answer to the question necessarily rests in finding a way of essentially enabling more human interaction. The answer to the question lies in reducing human interaction, and some of that may be by employers recognising that the stay-at-home message and the work-from-home message really must be complied with to a greater extent than perhaps people are thinking of doing just now, because without that, we will not reduce the level of human interaction by the necessary amount to ensure that we are effective in preventing the spread of the virus.
Thank you for that helpful answer. In terms of key workers who have been, there are some people that have been in touch to say that they've been refused key worker provision. Is there an appeal system for families? Can with local authorities, can they appeal against the decision where they've been refused this provision?
I think that the idea of a formal appeals mechanism, I think is perhaps to overstate the formality of the process. But I think what I would encourage is dialogue with local authorities about the situation that and the decisions that are made. Quite clearly, local authorities are following the explanation of the position from the government that we need to reduce human interaction. So as a consequence, local authorities will be taking decisions to try to minimise the numbers of children who are able to attend early learning and school settings where there are for the children of key worker families, because of the guidance that we've put in place as a government, which asks local authorities to keep that to a minimum. So local authorities will be operating within a framework the government has set, which is to try to reduce human interaction by keeping those placements to a minimum. So local authorities must be free to take those decisions at local level. I think that's the right position for us to adopt. But fundamentally, that means that not everybody is going to be able to secure a place for their child. That therefore requires employers to be cooperative and to work with us in relation to the definition of who is able to work from home and putting in place the arrangements to enable people to work from home, try to avoid that human interaction that takes place.
Thank you. My final question is on the arrangements for universities. The First Minister told Parliament on Monday that government was considering this week whether there will be any changes to the plans for a staggered return of colleges and universities. Are you able to give an update on that situation?
We will be providing further information on that question. That detail is being worked on as we speak, and I would expect the government to be able to give some further clarity on that question, but I'm not in a position this morning to give a final explanation of where we've reached on that point.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I turn next to Stuart McMillan, please?
Good morning, Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach. And also like to wish you both a happy new year. I've got a few questions regarding the number 10 regulations. And these have been stimulated by constituents who have contacted me over the last few days. The first one is regarding shielding. Now, the regulations are quite clear in terms of who should be shielding, but I've been contacted by a lady who herself She did shield last year for 12 weeks. And that wasn't because of her, it was because of her husband. Her husband has cystic fibrosis and a range of other health conditions. So she is really concerned that she's been asked to go into work, and she's concerned about taking that back home to put her husband's life in danger. So should that lady shield, or should she be attending work?
I'll perhaps invite Professor Leach to comment on this, but essentially the judgment there, I think, is best, or the best advice I can offer, is for the lady in question to raise these issues directly with her employer, because these are the type of circumstances where we are setting out as a government the type of approach that we believe is necessary to be undertaken, and are encouraging employers to work cooperatively with us in meeting a number of these challenges. So therefore, the question that Mr. McMillan puts to me is, I think, one best addressed by the dialogue between the lady and her employer, given the circumstances that she faces as not being an individual who's required by the current arrangements to shield, but for whom it would be beneficial to shield because of the necessity of protecting her husband's health and well-being. But Professor Leach may be able to offer some more insight on this question.
It's very difficult to be definitive, Mr. McMillan, on individual cases, but the general advice is, as the Deputy First Minister outlines it, there is higher risk in households of that type, of course. And a conversation both with the healthcare team, probably her husband's healthcare team, and with the employer would be exactly the route to go down. If the employer has choices, for example, I don't know what it is, let's say it's a call centre where some people can work from home and some people have to go in, then this would be the kind of lady I would hope that that workplace would be sympathetic to and allow her to work from home as much as can. If she has to go to work, it's not necessarily unsafe if everything is mitigated. So if she washes her hands, if she stays distant, if she can do all of that, I understand the anxiety of that, but that would be the advice. If she is a paramedic and has to be on the road, then that's an entirely different set of circumstances compared to others where there might be a little bit more flexibility. And I'm quite sure that family have developed a way of keeping themselves safe in and around their house, in and around those relationships. So it's not a unique story. So a conversation with the workplace and a conversation perhaps with her husband's care team may help unlock perhaps some flexibility.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for that. The second question, just regarding travel and work. If somebody has to travel for work, particularly if they have to go overseas, will they be provided with any type of documentary proof that they have received the vaccination? This might be more important for people who potentially work in the oil and gas sector, who do travel across the world.
I'll invite Professor Leach to respond to that question.
So not yet, no vaccine certification yet. I mean, the people will have evidence they've been vaccinated because they'll have letters or they'll have their appointment. But the problem just now is we don't know what vaccination means other than personal protection. We know it personally protects you up to a certain level. What we don't know is if it makes you safer on an oil rig, because we don't know about transmission yet. So that will come, Mr. McMillan. I'm confident a version of that will come once we know about transmission. And then the world will take a view on vaccine certification and what that means. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if that starts with high-risk industry, health and social care workers, nuclear power, oil and gas, and then works its way through society. But for now, we're unfortunately telling even the vaccinated not to change their behaviour.
Okay. Thank you for that. Next question just is regarding the first aid training. And I was contacted by a representative from St Andrews First Aid. They're just wondering as to whether guidance will be updated regarding first aid training in the workplace, because they're aware that there's another couple of organisations that are going to be doing the training, but there's a just seems to be a lack of clarity as to whether that should or should not be taking place over the course of the current the new measures that are being introduced.
So, Deputy First Minister, I can take this because I dealt with it yesterday. So I can't actually remember the detail, Mr. McMillan, of who is writing. It may be me. It may be the Cabinet Secretary for Health. I can't remember if I approved a letter in my own name or approved a letter on behalf of the Cabinet Secretary to send to her, for her then to send. But we did have correspondence from the organisations, the first aid organisations, and it was about the statutory nature of some first aid training for workplaces that had been stopped, for instance, in a factory that has to have it to function. And my advice was that much of that should be done online, as much as it can be. But if that needs to be face-to-face, then that is a legitimate reason for that workplace to have some face-to-face training for essential staff only. And that seemed a very sensible and pragmatic way forward. The organisations were looking for that kind of guidance, and we are doing that. If it hasn't already been done today, it's imminent.
That's helpful. Thank you very much. My final question on this is regarding free school meals. Obviously, there was prior to the December, there was the £100 million winter fund that was created, but that clearly would have taken into consideration the measures that we're discussing now. So, will pupils who are in receipt of free school meals, will they have any additional funding over this period to assist them with eating?
Well, the existing arrangements, what we put in place was free school meal provision for essentially the holiday periods, and that was additional provision that we'd put in place. Obviously, we're in term time just now, so which is fully funded for free school meals. So the schools will be making arrangements through local authorities for essentially the provision of free school meals to those who are eligible, and that will be done either by in a variety of fashions. Obviously, young people who are in school will be fed, those who are at home. It is largely now cash payments that are made to families, or in some cases it's voucher arrangements, but it tends to be gravitating towards cash payments, and that will be assured for families in this context.
Okay, well, thank you. And my final question is just regarding the access to waste recycling facilities. I'm conscious that, as you said this morning, Deputy First Minister, the need to reduce human interaction. And I know there are concerns with people who work in these facilities. I know on Monday, as I was driving through to Parliament for the recall, I went and dropped some stuff off, and one of the guys who was working there did actually raise the question with me. He'd indicated as to how busy it had been for the couple of days beforehand. Over 5,000 cars had been in, and it's a fairly small area. So they certainly were concerned in terms of the human interaction going into their facility in Greenock, but also this will be across the country, of course. Has there been any consideration given to the waste recycling facilities as to whether they should or should not remain open over this period, please?
This is one of the issues that I think I would put into the category of having the potential to be changed if we are not satisfied that the degree of human interaction is not reducing sufficiently within the country. Mr. McMillan will be familiar with the fact that there was a lot of difficulty with fly tipping as a consequence of the waste recycling facilities not being open. Now, I'm not used to that as a defence of fly tipping. Fly tipping is wholly unacceptable, but around about the time when the waste recycling centres were closed, there was an upsurge in fly tipping, and nobody wants to see that. But equally, the gentleman that spoke to Mr. McMillan, who works in the waste recycling centre, has got a fair point that if there's 5,000 cars being at that recycling centre in Greenock, then we just need to multiply that around waste recycling centres around the country. So I think these facilities are still able to operate, but clearly if we do not see a reduction in the level of interaction within society, then we may have to reconsider that position. And I come back to the fundamental point that the law now says that people cannot leave home without a reasonable excuse. Now, I'm not sure quite why one would need to go to a waste recycling centre to leave home for that purpose in the current context, unless, you know, I think you really have to stretch the definition of reasonable excuse to justify making that journey. So I think the getting people to follow faithfully the stay-at-home regulations and not to leave without reasonable excuse is, I think, a central part of making sure that the circumstances that Mr. McMillan narrates to me are not the circumstances that continue at waste recycling centres in the future.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you for that. Can we next have Willie Coffey, please?
Thanks, Donald. Good morning. I wonder if I could ask a question to John, firstly. John, it's about the online learning model that we are operating in schools. As I understand it, it's not a real-time interactive face-to-face type of model that we have in place. And I'm wondering if we're thinking about trying to get to that, to produce a more richer, more real-time, more live kind of learning experience for children and young people in schools, to make the best of the technology that we have that's there. I wonder if you could tell us a wee bit about that and whether there are any barriers to doing that kind of model as the norm, the way of exchanging and learning in schools.
We've described the model that is going to be taken forward from Monday as a remote learning model, which should encompass a range of different aspects of learning. Some of it should involve live learning of the type that Mr. Coffey raises with me. It won't all be live learning, because I think that would be it would be physically very difficult to deliver such a proposition on the normal school day, for example, of 9 to 3 of constant live learning. So there will be elements of live learning, and the guidance that we will publish will require a daily interaction with young people in a live learning context. There will also be other elements of independent learning. There will be the utilisation of some broadcasting technologies that are available through the partnership between or the working together between BBC Scotland and Education Scotland in the production of some broadcasting output that will be available to everybody with a television. And then there will also be the access to the eSchool, which has been an investment the government has been making over the course of the last 2 years, which essentially involves the curating of recorded lessons, the delivery of some live learning, and the delivery of tutorial support for students, which is undertaken under the umbrella of the eSchool. And there are many lessons that have now been recorded and are available as part of the eSchool, which is available to anybody in Scotland who has access to the GLOW network. And I suppose the last element is the GLOW network, where the government has invested over many years in the provision of GLOW as essentially an educational technology that's available to every pupil whose local authority makes provision for them for that, which provides access to a wide range of learning opportunities. But fundamentally, the direction of the remote learning will be undertaken by individual schools, individual teachers, relating directly to their pupils. They will know where their pupils are in the curriculum. They'll know what stage they're at. They'll know what is the relevant learning to be taken forward. and all of that material will be able to be undertaken under the umbrella of remote learning, which will involve live learning.
A good thorough answer, Joe. In the dim and distant past, when I worked with Education Scotland, GLOW was fairly familiar to me too, and the online learning environments were fairly advanced. Then I was just wondering if the local authorities have got the flexibility to do more face-to-face if they want to do that, either on a one-to-one basis or a one-to-many basis. Are there any barriers to that? Is there GDPR issues in there, for example, that might stop us exploiting that to the best of our ability?
There shouldn't be GDPR issues. There are various opportunities through, part of what GLOW offers is, what comes with GLOW is essentially access to all of the provisions of Office 365 and Google Classroom. So there's essentially that platform is available for schools to utilise if they are GLOW users. Now, not all local authorities opted to be GLOW users. They have some of local authorities, a minority of local authorities have their own systems and schemes that they put in place, which are largely built around about Office 365. But there is certainly the opportunity and the technology available for lessons to be delivered live. And obviously the government has invested heavily in devices to enable those young people who don't have devices to be able to be to be able to have access. We did a data collection exercise which estimated that about 70,000 young people in Scotland did not have devices or access to appropriate devices. And on the information that's currently available to me, the investment that we made in partnership with local authorities looks to me to have reached about 70,000 young people. Now, we continue to monitor whether or not there is still unmet demand out there, and we're working with local authorities to address that. But there certainly should be no impediment to the delivery of a classroom-style live lesson of the type that Mr. Coffey raises with me.
Okay, thank you very much for that. That's a very thorough answer, John. I wonder if I could ask a question to Professor Leach. It's about transmission of the virus within the hospital setting or within the recovery setting. I'm hearing some constituents telling me that their loved ones, when admitted to hospital or to recovery, are picking up the virus in that setting. Are people generally in hospital a priority to receive the vaccine while they're in hospital, or must they wait their turn when they, as part of the general population?
Yeah, so the what we call nosocomial infection rate remains, of course, too high, like it always is for any infectious agent. It follows the community transmission. In fact, the second wave, if anything, it's slightly below the community transmission rate because of the work of the hundreds of health service workers and the visitors following the instructions and the patients following the instructions. But with numbers so high in the community, in Inverclyde, for example, or in the Fleece and Galloway now, that it gets harder to keep it out. That's the simple reality. Sometimes it's tricky to know if it was inside the hospital or a patient brought it in. So in the publication that many of you will be familiar with, we have a definite, probable, and not. And so it is, if somebody's been in for 14 days and they get the virus, it's likely they caught it in the hospital. If they were in for 4 days, it's likely they brought it in. So vaccination will go through the age groups in the hospital and out of hospital. So vaccination will be prioritised for health and social care workers, anybody who's near patients, anybody who's in laboratories, that kind of individual who's at higher risk. Because remember, a number of health and social care workers have tragically died of this disease. And with that group, the over 80s, whether they're in hospital or in a care home, if it's safe to do so. So it's not always quite as straightforward as that, because somebody could be in intensive care and on lots of medication, and we want to be more careful. That will be risk assessed by clinical teams. But yes, the age ranges in hospital will be treated in the same way. And some of the first people to get the vaccine, in fact, were inpatients because they were so accessible to us. We were able to get to them quicker.
Mm-hmm. Good. And a final question to you, Professor Leach, that I'm asked by constituents. Is the second dose of all of the vaccines exactly the same as the first dose of the vaccines? And by that I mean, is it the same volume, the same quantity, strength, or whatever?
It is presently. It's presently taken from the same vial, clearly a different vial, but the same type of vial, and it's exactly the same dose. Now, that might change over time, but for now, the Joint Commission, the Joint Committee and the MHRA advice is that we should use the same doses. There was some work early on about low dose first, high dose second, not enough trial data to suggest that gives any more protection. And it appears, again, as I said at the beginning, the great surprise to us was the level of protection you get from that single first dose. So the second dose gives you a little bit more protection, that's true, but it elongates the protection for sure. So yes, same dose just now, and it's important. For now, we are giving people the same company's vaccine second dose. Yes. That again might not be true in the future if the trials suggest we don't need to do that. So hepatitis B vaccination for healthcare workers, we do that in a single dose and then a booster dose. The booster dose, it doesn't matter if it was made by the same company, it's the same vaccine. So that may change, but for now, same manufacturer, second dose.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. Thank you to both of you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Next, we have Maurice Corrie, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach. In the relation to the supply of vaccine and its process, is the Scottish Government, Deputy First Minister, confident that the supply will continue to roll out well and also on schedule and planned? And also the part being played by the UK Armed Forces in supporting this is obviously there now and probably well maybe stepped up by some comments you made earlier. Can you comment on that, please, Deputy First Minister?
Certainly. I think in relation to the supply of the vaccine, I am confident in the arrangements and hopeful that the arrangements can be sustained. But, you know, I think I have to put in the caveat that we're not producing the vaccine. It's been produced by other people. And I know that from the discussions that ministers have had with Pfizer and I think also by now or maybe just about to happen with Oxford AstraZeneca, that the companies and organisations are absolutely committed and devoted to making sure that the delivery schedules are maintained. It's in nobody's interest for that not to be the case. But I have to put that caveat in that we are not the producers of the vaccine. We are dependent on others to do so. But I am assured of the dedication of the organisations to the delivery of the vaccine. Now, there are extensive vaccine delivery arrangements already in place within the country, and these involve a vast number of personnel, some of them within the health service, some of them not, and some of them within the armed forces. And we have benefited enormously from the contribution of the armed forces to the testing arrangements, and that's been really welcome and of a great assistance. And I'm not sufficiently close to the detail around the involvement of the military on the vaccination, but if that was to be involved, that would equally be very welcome to me. But Professor Leach may be able to provide absolute clarity on the military involvement in the delivery of the vaccination.
Thank you. Professor Leach, would you like to make a comment on that last point that the Deputy First Minister made?
Yeah, so the vaccine supply is a slightly complex arrangement, as you can imagine, depending on where it comes from, who makes it, which factory it comes from. And then because what we've done here is the MHRA have given us approval to supply, they haven't, strictly speaking, licensed the medication because it's all happened so quickly. Approval to supply means there are extra layers of safety and protection built into the process. So when it comes out of the factory into the National Health Service's hands, we have to redo some safety checks. So all of that creates extra steps in the process, going very fast and going very well, but it just explains sometimes why the out the factory into the NHS warehouse, there's an extra step, and then out to the individual NHSs, and then out to health boards or trusts across some of my colleagues' environments. The armed forces have been involved in each of those steps, particularly in the logistics and helping us think about that. They don't have to be quite so involved in the actual supply. We've already, frankly, got all the military nurses and doctors working for us already. There are very few who just work for the forces now. It's usually they work for us and the forces borrow them and deploy them in Cyprus or Afghanistan or wherever. So we're very grateful that they've stepped up to help us, probably more than full-time. I was going to say full-time, certainly more than that. And we have the procurement logisticians available to us when we need them, just like we've used them for testing centres as we move to mass vaccination centres, which we're not at yet, not because we're not ready, we're not at yet because we don't have the supply. They wouldn't be necessary yet. Then we will use them as and when we need them, and they've volunteered and are able to do that.
Okay, thank you for that question. One further question. Can I take you to the point of the elderly people in our community groups who are being looked after in the third sector, often with paid staff and volunteer staff, who might be around in areas in my own town, we have one called Grey Matters, where we have about 70 elderly people. Now, the question has come up to me from them is they're seeing a distinct dip in the psychological sides of these people because they're not really being able to come together. Now, the question is, looking at the priority, the JCVI priority for vaccination, it seems to me that the people who look after these groups within these communities, many of them are volunteers, are actually priority two. The problem here is if these people get vaccinated, and indeed the helpers obviously get vaccinated along with the elderly people, the question is, we obviously have faith that we can't bring them together, but can we have a sort of commitment from yourself, Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach, that these volunteers who maybe young, obviously are younger and who help and members of staff will actually get more prioritisation in vaccination for those community groups?
I completely understand the point that Mr. Corey is making to me, and appreciate its significance, because the psychological impact of these of environment in this context on older people is acute. It's acute on everybody, but I think it's particularly acute on some older people who have relied significantly or got great benefit out of the type of groupings that Mr. Corey refers to, and I'm familiar with them in my own constituency and also in my own personal life. So these are I do understand the significance. The challenge here, of course, is that we are following advice given to us by the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation, which has, and I don't want to sound too blunt here, but essentially been designed on a basis of how to minimise death from the virus. That's the basis of the JCVI advice. And that requires us to go through the sequence of groupings with which Mr. Corey and the committee will be familiar. To deviate from that, obviously, essentially increases the risk from somebody who is perceived under the JCVI framework to be more at risk of infection and death than another individual. So there's really quite a difficult issue in there that has to be addressed. So I can't give I can give Mr. Corey an assurance that these issues have been are being actively considered within government, but I can't give an assurance about how that will be concluded, because the JCVI advice, as Professor Leach said earlier, is very significant advice that governments have always tended to follow, and gives us advice based on really quite a hard assessment of prioritisation of the dangers that individuals face.
Thank you, Dr. Professor.
Mr. Corey, Yeah, the only thing I would add to that, and it's a very good answer from the Deputy First Minister. The only thing I would add is that I completely agree with you that one of the deep and horrible things that these restrictions do is exactly what you describe and your constituents describe for our elderly population. That loss of person-to-person interaction at the lunch clubs, at the mosques, at the places of worship around the country is a huge problem. And it has to be one of the first things we bring back. It has to be for the well-being of that population. So the first and most important thing is to vaccinate that population, not necessarily their carers, because they're not at high risk of death. I'm sorry to be so blunt. The people at high risk of death are the people using that lunch club or that community setting. Mm. With mitigations, we can protect the younger people who are providing the care in a much more meaningful way, and we can reassure them and communicate with them about how they are more protected. And even if they get the disease, they're likely to have a mild course of it, not guaranteed. The Joint Committee has present advice. That advice may well change as we move into mass vaccination with huge numbers and we begin to understand transmission better. Just now, we are, as we've said a couple of times now, we are protecting individuals from dying. And that's why the Joint Committee has its present advice. Once we vaccinate 2 million people and we begin to see reductions in transmission, or whenever that happens, that might change the Joint Committee's advice about where you should go next. So for now, it's about individual death.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I turn next to Annabel Ewing, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the Deputy First Minister and to Professor Leach, and a happy new year to both of you. And thank you for all that you do. I've got three broad areas, and I'll just list them and then I'll go into the specific questions. The first would concern business support, and in relation to that, also, of course, the position of workers, many of whom, it seems to me, are being forced to go into work, and to discuss that a wee bit. Second, the issue of vaccines, a few questions, for example, about discussions and looking at extending that to teachers and childcare workers, and a few other technical questions. And thirdly, just looking at education in the longer term and taking into account the impacts on young people in this last year and how that will be reflected in the years that they have ahead at school. So on the issue of business support, perhaps I'll ask the First Minister, where's our £375 million new money from the UK Chancellor that he announced on Monday, I believe? Where is that? Do we know?
Well, where it is it's part of the already announced consequentials that the UK government has set out to the Scottish government. So I think, as the Welsh government has confirmed, the Chancellor's announcement on Monday did not generate, on the Tuesday, it did not generate any further consequentials that we were not already aware of as a consequence of the announcement. And that's a matter of regret, because I think if I could be charitable, a rather confused appearance around about that information. And of course, there's a serious issue that lies underneath this, which is about trying to put in place the financial support that individual companies need to get to the other side of this pandemic. And that's what the government is trying to do in Scotland. We're trying to find the targeted support that will get companies through this. And obviously, there was a rather unfortunate lack of clarity on Tuesday about that point.
Well, yes, I believe that the Deputy First Minister is being his usual diplomatic self, because I would say that it was really a blatant disregard for the interests of business in Scotland, because it was quite clear in the press release what was being said. It was new money, and then suddenly the press release overnight was changed. I think it's a complete disregard for Scottish business, but we are where we are, and I understand that further support is being looked at. And in that regard, and going back to the key message, I think, of this morning, which is that the new measures are the rationale is to reduce human interaction and therefore transmission. And in that regard, therefore, looking at business from the employee side of things, I fear that a number of employees are in effect being forced to go into work and not being given the option of working at home or looking at other financial measures which may for that particular worker not be as advantageous for the company itself. But if the rationale for the lockdown is to reduce interaction and therefore transmission, what further discussions can the Scottish Government have with business to get this message across? Because it is in nobody's interest for increased transmission, because that just prolongs this whole misery and does not help the economy and does not help business. Deputy First Minister.
There's two different aspects to this question. The first is around the extent of the restrictions that we put in place. And I think in my earlier answers to members of the committee this morning, I've made it clear that we are still considering whether there is a need to put in place further restrictions that would require, by law, organisations to close. And obviously, if that happens, then that changes the ability of organisations to act. It therefore means that employees can pursue can be put on the furlough scheme, which is still available, which is a helpful intervention to have available. We can reduce some of that interaction potentially by applying more restrictions and enabling more people to furlough. The second part is then about whether employers are looking carefully enough at whether individuals can actually continue to contribute to the company while working from home, by working from home. And that's the clear exhortation of the government's message and the approach that we are taking. We discussed that. The Economy Secretary was discussing that issue with business organisations on Wednesday. And those discussions go on a constant basis, where we encourage business organisations to replicate that message directly to their member organisations. So there are a whole range of ways in which we can advance that message to make sure that we minimise the level of human interaction. But fundamentally, we may well have to come back to revisiting the restrictions to try to get the fall off in cases that we require to see taking place.
Thank you for that answer. Turning to the issue of vaccines, obviously the First Minister in her statement on Monday referred to the fact that consideration was being given, or at least the issue was being looked at, and that was the issue of vaccination of teachers and childcare workers. And it would be interesting to hear where those deliberations are and how that would fit in if that were pursued to the phase one programme that has already been set out. And the other question on vaccines, which is concerns the second dose, and therefore the huge importance of the messaging around the need, the absolute requirement to go back to get the second dose. So perhaps I don't know if the DFM wants to come in on that, and then Professor Leach on more technical issues. Thank you.
If I deal with the first part of it, as I explained to Mr. Corey in my answer, the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation Advice is very clear, and it's driven by the a categorisation that tries to minimise infection and death, frankly. So it's going through the older age population groups, those most directly exposed to health and social care work, through the age groups, to those with underlying conditions, until it gets down to the over 50s, and then the wider population is vaccinated. Now, of course, within that first phase, a lot of teachers will be and early learning workers will and school staff will be vaccinated because they will be over 50 or they will have underlying health conditions. Obviously, if that was to be extended to all members of school staff and early learning centre staff, that would, in the absence of a significantly expanded volume of vaccine availability than we think is coming to us, would then essentially erode that prioritisation by the Joint Committee, which is based on a very strong clinical and ethical rationale. So we're working our way through all of these issues to see if there is more that can be done in that respect. But I think it's important for me to state today that the JCVI advice is what the government has accepted and what is being applied, and that will include teachers and early learning staff and school staff who are in the categories that are already identified before we get on to the wider population group that are pursued. So those discussions and that analysis is ongoing within government just now, and will be the subject of further dialogue. And I'll leave Jason Leach to address the more technical issue.
So I first of all, I agree with what Mr. Swinney has said around the nature of that prioritisation. That I have an inbox full of different groups around the country wishing to be prioritised. So that's why it's important to have an independent group of scientists to help us with that prioritisation. Your second point is crucial, that although we have extended the gap on advice from 3 weeks to 12 weeks, the second dose is still crucial and will particularly provide an elongation of immunity, because it gives you a slightly different type of antibodies, and the immunology shows us the curve goes on for much longer. We're not quite sure how long yet. We will, of course, get in touch with everybody who we've done the first dose to. We will have records for them. We will contact them. There may be some bumps on the road about people getting access and people turning up, but the fundamental piece of communication is that you should come for your second dose just like you've come for your first dose. Please don't think you are as protected as you can be, because we want it to last as long as it can, while we work out whether we need to do it every year or whether we need to do it every 2 years or what happens to the virus. We will do what we can in that communication, of course, but you, others, everybody should reinforce those messages for us.
Thank you, and we absolutely will, certainly I will, and I hope I speak with my colleagues as well. My last question, as I indicated, concerns a look ahead in terms of education, and particularly for secondary school pupils, I would have thought, and pupils in my constituency, young people in my constituency and across Scotland, we would all be absolutely desperate to ensure that there was parity going forward, and that any inequality suffered as a result of COVID is not carried forward in effect year to year. And I know that's a big question, but I suppose what I'm just seeking at the moment is that these issues are under active reflection by the government, because of very serious issues that affect a young person's opportunity that they get through school. Thank you.
That aspiration lies at the heart of my whole approach as Education Secretary. And prior to COVID, Annabel, you will be familiar, the government was, and my priority was entirely focused on closing the poverty-related attainment gap, which relates to the circumstances of many of Annabel Ewan's constituents. That approach has prevailed throughout all of how we've handled COVID. We are taking forward the equity audit, which is designed to identify what further steps we can take to address issues of equity within the education system and in the delivery of some of the interventions we've made, particularly around the delivery of digital devices, for example, that has been focused on those young people who do not have access to either devices or connectivity to enable them to sustain their learning. We're obviously taking steps to make sure that there is that there is fairness for all candidates in the SQA process, and that is the subject of ongoing discussions. And in every respect, we are doing all that we can to try to ensure that young people are not in any way prejudiced by the nature of their background from being able to achieve their potential within our education system.
Thank you for those answers. Can I turn next to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, convener. And if I can, first of all, ask about the vaccines and the change in policy from the 3 weeks to the 12 weeks. I think there's been some suggestion that the World Health Organization does not agree with that change. And I think previously, although AstraZeneca seemed to be happy, I'm not sure that Pfizer were quite so happy about it. So is there any update about the WHO and Pfizer's position?
If I could invite Professor Leach to respond to that point.
Yeah, so Pfizer have played this with a fairly straight bat. If you actually read what Pfizer said rather than the headlines, Pfizer have said, our trials looked for this outcome and did this thing. And that is all true. Nothing Pfizer have said is not true. They haven't specifically come out and said, don't do what the Joint Committee has said, which is a different thing. The Joint Committee have a different role to Pfizer, and the Joint Committee looked at Pfizer's data, published and unpublished, looked at the data and said what we've just described. The WHO also is worthy of considerable study. The WHO have said, depending on where you are in your pandemic, depending the state of play in your pandemic, you should adjust your vaccine design, your vaccine process, according to the position you find yourself in. So if we were doing an annual COVID vaccination with almost no prevalence, this is what you would do with vaccination type A. If you're in what is literally an emergency situation just now, where London is running out of intensive care beds, literally running out of intensive care beds today, then you may do something slightly different because you need to, as an emergency, protect that very high-risk population. And that's what we've done. There was an interesting interview yesterday on Good Morning Scotland with one of the Joint Committee members who had spoken to the WHO overnight, the head of vaccination at the WHO, and said that he had been assured by the WHO they in no way wanted to suggest that the 12 weeks was not something the UK should do. They were just pointing out the facts of what Pfizer had said, what vaccination is, and giving permission, we don't need it from the WHO, but giving permission for the UK to take a view through the Joint Committee about saving those extra lives.
Thanks very much for that. My second question would be, assuming we go back to the levels at some point, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, I mean, previously there were certain kind of indicators or drivers for going into each level. Does the fact that we've got this new variant and therefore if 100 people have the virus now, that is more worrying than if 100 people had it previously? Does that change the measures for the levels?
I think what we have to make a careful judgment about is the extent to which the prevalence of the virus is on a downward trajectory. That is the key element of what we have to see emerging on a sustained basis to give us confidence that the measures are having the effect that they need to have. And I think it's what we would probably be better to avoid is specific thresholds of particular, that gain access to particular sectors, to particular tiers, I should say. But that we should focus much more on what is the pattern and the trajectory of the infection. If I give Mr. Mason one example, which rather haunts me, of the levels process, and that's of Midlothian, where we saw Midlothian reaching a particular level. We thought that represented an opportunity to move Midlothian from level 3 to level 2. We gave advance notice of that, with which everybody was happy. But the trajectory wasn't strong enough, and it ended up going the opposite direction. And we had to not apply the change to Midlothian, which was a disappointment to people in that locality. But it was the right decision to take because we'd not seen the sustained reduction that we needed to see to give us confidence that the virus was moving in the right direction. So there is a need for us to enable there to be much greater sort of line of sight around the progress of the virus at any given time.
Okay. We had already planned, Mr. Mason, we had already planned a review of the strategic framework and the levels prior to knowing about the new variant. The new variant makes that, I was going to say more urgent, that's probably not correct. It makes it different. And there will be clinical advice, four harms advice, going to Cabinet and Mr. Swinney around exactly what we think that might look like, when and if we get to a point where we think we can relax some of these restrictions. Remember, we still, at some level, have the levels in place because the islands are being treated slightly differently from the mainland. So at some level, what's in those levels is still important at this point, and they do need reviewed in light of both our learning from them and now the new variant.
Thanks very much. And my third and I think final question, probably aimed at Mr. Swinney. Traditionally, there has been a complete separation or a fairly strong separation between the church and the state in Scotland. And some of the churches, at least, are arguing that the state should not be intervening and telling them not to have services, not to meet, and so on. And I just wondered if you could comment on how you would respond to that kind of point.
I think the issue here is one of great difficulty because nobody in the government wants to restrict anybody's ability to take part in communal religious worship. It's the last thing on earth I want to do. But we have to acknowledge, and this is the point that's run through all of my answers today, where there is human interaction, in whatever context, whether it's an early learning centre, a school, a factory, a shop, a bank, a hospital, a church, a place of worship, there is the opportunity for the virus to spread. And therefore, if we are getting to a point where, as a society, we cannot confidently assume that our National Health Service is going to be able to withstand the growth of infection because of the level of human interaction in our society, we have got to take action to minimise that level of human interaction. And that is crucial in arresting the levels of the virus within our society. And sadly and regrettably, and very much to my personal regret, that cannot exclude places of worship, because we have to acknowledge that places of worship are places where people come together. There is the potential for the virus to spread, and if we do not take action to minimise that, then we are not fulfilling the necessity of interrupting the flow and circulation of the virus. Now, I don't think anybody should read into that any step that changes the fundamental nature of the relationship between the church and the state. And I certainly don't read anything into of that nature. This is about protecting the public from a very serious virus and making sure that places of worship are able to play their part in that effort.
Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, questions from Gordon Lyndhurst, please.
Thank you, Convener and Deputy First Minister. I think my questions follow on to a certain extent from what has just been asked. Freedom of thought, conscience and religion to manifest in public religion or belief in worship, teaching, practice and observance is a fundamental human right referred to expressly in the European Convention on the Human Rights Act. So your comparison between attending a place of worship and attending the bank, for example, are not necessarily appropriate, if I may put it that way, because attending the bank is not referred to as a fundamental human right. There are other fundamental human rights as well, of course. Now, the right includes, of course, attending services at places of worship, and that continues to be respected by governments in other nations in Europe, North America, and indeed here in the British Isles, on the basis of adherence to social distancing and other evidentially and scientifically based requirements. Yet here in Scotland, the First Minister and your government have set out regulations in SSI 11, which entirely curtail that fundamental right. So constituents have contacted me, upset, very concerned about this. And it's on their behalf that I'm raising this issue with you. What is the basis for curtailment of fundamental right?
I would not contend that fundamental right is being curtailed here, and I'll come on to explain my rationale for that in a moment. Fundamentally, and my point in relation to the context within which individuals may undertake human interaction and may contract the virus was not designed in any way to equate religious worship with attending the bank. It was about making the point that wherever people gather together, there is a risk that the virus will be spread. And that is the only point that I'm making in that respect. And as Mr. Lyndhurst understands, the right to education is a fundamental right as well, which we are delivering in a different fashion to the normal delivery of education within a school setting. I suppose that brings me to the point on religious observance and the ability to pursue one's right to take part in religious worship. Every Sunday morning, we sit in this house and we participate in a Catholic Mass led by a number of different leaders of the Catholic Church. But we do that within our own home, safely, able to participate in religious worship, in exercising our fundamental rights. So our rights are in no way constrained by the restrictions, but we are able to play our part in ensuring that we don't contribute towards the circulation of the virus to any greater extent within our society, nor that we bring that virus into our house, which would be a significant issue for us here as well. So I think the government has taken a decision which is based on addressing the need to minimise the level of human interaction within our society, but still enables individuals to participate in religious worship in the fashion that they wish to do so.
I think Professor Leach wanted to come in, Gordon. Just hear from Professor Leach and then come
back. Thank you, Convener. Briefly, just to reassure Mr. Lyndhurst that none of this has been done lightly. If I don't know if you know me well, but you perhaps will know that places of worship has probably been the toughest piece of advice we've had to give, and it affects me deeply personally. I have met with Scotland's faith leaders throughout this pandemic. I met with them again this week from all faiths, including representatives of the Catholic bishops who wrote the letter which was published this week. I explained the public health position to them. I got a very fair hearing. They explained their position. My advice remained the same. Every country in the UK has made this decision at some point during the pandemic. The places of worship have not been open in any country of the UK throughout the pandemic. And we feel, unfortunately, that one of the last things to close should be places of worship. It should also be one of the first places to reopen. In last week's test and protect data, 120 people went to places of worship during the infectious period. 120 people. That creates a risk that I am unwilling to take in the advice I give to the decision makers. The decision makers then choose what to do with that advice. That's their job. But inside that advice, and particularly because of a broad demographic attending places of worship, all age, all disease, and you can't protect those individuals, I'm afraid, robustly enough, then at this point in the pandemic, I think it's the right thing to do.
Well, the figure that you mentioned, that would be something that would be helpful, I think, if the basically the detail of the decision making process, I think the sharing of how that was followed through to determine the decision on in this occasion. So I think the individual assessments made in relation to each area of Scotland, any evidence that the virus has been spread as a result of worship services being held themselves, and also the legal understanding, the basis of which those assessments and the evidence and the question of proportionality to take what I would say is a drastic step has been taken. I think, is that something that the Deputy First Minister would be willing to share with myself and the committee? And I think it would be helpful to individuals who are concerned about this to have an understanding at least some level. I don't think any of that information is confidential or something that couldn't be shared publicly. Because, of course, human interaction is being allowed. So the question is not that the government is stopping human interaction. The government is choosing what human interaction is allowed to take place. And others will not share the Deputy First Minister's view that participating or viewing an online service is human interaction or is allowing them to exercise their right to public worship. And certainly that is a view which is, as I say, respected by other governments, particularly at this late stage. I mean, we're almost a year into this pandemic. It's perfectly understandable closing places of worship, perhaps the first 4 or 5 weeks, as many, many different activities were shut down until we had some understanding, but we're well beyond that. So I would ask the Deputy First Minister if he is willing to share that detailed information with the committee and myself.
I'm certainly prepared to make available to the committee the rationale for the government's decision on places of worship. I've explained it in the answers that I have given and the scale of difficulty that this decision represented for ministers. So I'm very happy to make that material, that rationale available to the committee and any supporting evidence that we can provide to assist Mr. Lowthurst and the committee in their discussions.
If I might just ask, will that be available before this matter comes before Parliament for any decision on the SSI?
We can try to do that as swiftly as we possibly can do.
Thank you.
I should perhaps add, Mr. Lowthurst, that the data you seek is impossible. It is unavailable. I cannot tell you where everybody got the virus. Every sector asks for exactly that data. All I can tell you is where people were during their infectious period. I cannot tell you they passed it on to Frank or Mary, or they got it from Frank or Mary because of the incubation period of this particular infectious agent. So just like hospitality seek that data, so do those advocating, like me, for places of worship, seek that data. That data is unavailable.
Perhaps, if I might just come back, Professor Leach, you say that. I'm just wondering why, as I say, different health authorities on a very broad basis have taken a different view about allowing places of worship to remain open.
Well, that's ultimately a matter of the decisions that ministers arrive at and the degree to which we take steps which we believe are appropriate to try to interrupt the circulation of a virus, and that's fundamentally, you know, we have a range of different options that are available to us on the steps that we can take, and ministers are ultimately accountable for the steps that they take, and that's what we do with the advice that is provided to us by advisors such as Professor Leach, and we reflect on that and we take decisions accordingly.
I'm going to have to interrupt here because we've gone over time anyway. And can I just thank all members for their attendance this morning? And in particular, can I thank the Deputy First Minister and the National Clinical Director for coming to give evidence to us? It's greatly appreciated, especially as we have, as I've just said, drifted beyond the original end of time. So that concludes our consideration of this agenda item and concludes the public part of this meeting. The committee will now discuss agenda item 3 in private, and I invite everyone to change over to Microsoft Teams for the next part of the meeting. And can I now suspend the meeting to allow that to happen? Thank you.